Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back to the stage your host for Teaching and Learning 2016, the President and CEO of the National Board, Peggy Brookins.
Good morning. In keeping with the theme, I have to ask you, how are you feeling? All right, good, good. One of the things that has happened this past weekend, there are thousands of us who met in Washington, but there are other teachers down, our friends in Australia, we're also meeting, doing similar work, and they are starting what they call their HALT program, H-A-L-T, like our MBCT program. So we want to give them some Twitter love this morning, and by sending them a message at hashtag H-A-L-T-Summit16. So let's let Down Under hear from us and let them know we have some love for them as well. They're making a difference, and all of you are making a difference as well. And one of the ways that I think I make a difference is about a year and a half ago, I was invited to serve on a White House commission for educational excellence for African Americans. The work has been phenomenal. I'm honored and proud of the work that we've done on this commission. And one of the biggest parts of the work is that I get to engage with this guy named David Johns, the initiative's director. David is a pleasure to work with. He is incredibly talented and wicked smart. He has significant experience in education policy, both at the legislative and executive branches. He's also worked on issues affecting low-income and minority students, neglected youth, and early childhood education. So, ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to my fellow commissioner, David Johns.
Yes, I will. Good morning. It's good to be back. Raise your hand if you were here with us last year. All right, we had a good time, so we're gonna have a good time again today. Let me begin with the most important thing, which is to say thank you. On behalf of President Barack Obama, our very fabulous First Lady Michelle Obama, and our new Secretary of Education, John King, thank you for the work that you do every single day for our children, our communities, and our country. If you hear me say nothing else, please hear me when I say thank you. I try and say it as often as I can, especially not on Teacher Appreciation Day or week. But you guys do God's work, and it is not often that you get celebrated for doing that which most people could never do. So thank you, thank you, thank you. So what I'm going to do is invite a couple of friends to help us have a conversation about cultural competency. I know that that is a word that gets used quite a bit. Almost like equity has become the new green jobs, right? Where people say it so often, you're kind of like, what does that really mean? And more importantly, what's required to ensure that we not only use the word, but make it meaningful in our practice in intentional ways. And so we're just going to have a very candid conversation. Everybody say conversation. And before we open it up, I'll give my ground rules. Those who were not here last year are like, what is that? Everybody will understand momentarily. We're just going to keep it going. And I encourage everyone as well to continue the conversation via social media. If you take a picture of me, please use the Valencia filter, right? Just you Valencia, then move the light two-thirds of the way to the right. It has a very nice living effect. Try it. First and foremost, I want to welcome to the stage colleague and mentor and friend, Linda Darling Hammond. She is president and CEO of the Learning Policy Institute and the Charles E. Duhamel Professor of Education Emeritus at Stanford University. Hero to most of us in this room. That was nice. I wish that happened everywhere I went. Next to the stage is a young rock star, Marley Diaz. I can just stop right there, right? She doesn't really need an introduction. Come on out here, Marley. F- For those who don't know, she's a literacy advocate and a shining example of the brilliance that exists within all of our babies, and a testament to what happens when caring and concerned adults listen to what it is that our children say they need. And she's beautiful, and she's brilliant, and she's Black. Next up to the stage is Dr. Ali Michael, Director of P-12 Consulting Services and Professional Development at the Center for the Study of Race and Equity in Education at the University of Pennsylvania. Next is Renee Moore, NBCT, Adolescence and Young Adulthood English Language Arts and Writing Project Fellow for the Delta Writing Project. Next up is another young rock star, Maria Salmarone. She's a junior at Montgomery County High School and is in the Minority Scholars Program. She's the leader. And last but certainly not least is my brother from another mother, Jose Bilson, educator and founder of EduColor. Give him a round of applause. A round of applause for all that they've done. So what I'd like to do is first be really clear and highlight in the fact that there are two young people on this panel. It is incredibly important, and you have heard me say this before, I'm going to say it again, that whenever we have conversations about our children, whenever there's a question or an opportunity about what we as adults can do to support them, it is essential that they are not only in the room, but they have a seat at the center of the table. And so it is our practice that when we are an extended invitation, our primary rule for accepting or engaging is that there are young people here. And so I want to honor that, and we're going to start with the two of you. And the question is simply this. We talk a lot about the need for cultural competency or diversity in many forms. Ground for everyone here and those who will listen to this, why that's important. Marley, why don't you start?
I think it's important because a sense of identity is important for kids so that they can go out into the world and know who they are before someone opposes them. Because if someone were to tell me that I'm not smart and I'm not brilliant, I've already been told thousands of times by my parents and my grandparents and my family and friends, before someone has to tell me that I'm not, for me to believe.
And before Maria, so listen, Linda, y'all gonna be clapping all day because everything they say is gonna be really brilliant. So let's, I'm just saying. So will you connect that to the impetus for you starting the program, right? And talk about what happened in fifth grade and how this larger, sometimes theoretical conversation about cultural competency and the diversity showed up in your life.
Yeah, that's definitely important. But in the class, there was a lot of us, and we were a very diverse group, but we were only reading about white boys and their dogs, so it felt like, although we all knew who we weren't seeing it in any other place besides looking at each other. And that's how the campaign really started, because I wasn't seeing anything different, and I see all these people, but I'm not reading it. And reading is something that parents push so much to us, but we're not seeing anything different every time we open up a book.
Appreciate that. And Maria, same question to you. How does it show up in your life as a student?
Well, as a student, well, first off, I am an example of diversity. I am a Black Latino student. I am from Honduras. So since I was young, I've always been used to just be able to face other perspectives coming from different cultures and being able to just from moving all around the place. I've always just been around that. So I've noticed how it's changed my life, and just having diversity and not embracing it is like having something great and not taking advantage of it. So we have to do it together. That's just what diversity is.
If y'all are tweeting, that was the line to tweet. Right? and I wanna go a little deeper. You started by naming multiple identities, and in particular honoring intersectionality, right? Identifying that you are Afro-Latina,
yes.
Which is important because often we look at people who are dark in a particular way and just assume an identity, right? And sometimes don't even do the work to understand that we're not a monolith, even though we might share same hue. So why was that important, and or how does that show up in your classroom experience?
Well, first off, I get to speak from two perspectives. I get to speak from the Black student perspective and the Hispanic student perspective. So I get to have kind of the best of both worlds. And then I sit in the classroom and I see how both, I see how like Black students get affected and how Hispanic students get affected. So that just leads to like me thinking a different way and me being able to be more open-minded towards different things.
Awesome, thank you. Let's open this up a bit, and Professor Darling Hammond, I'm gonna start with you. Will you connect the theory to the practice? So how do we go from understanding the importance of ensuring that all students know not only who they are, but whose they are, but to how it is that all educators can embrace this concept of cultural diversity or competence?
You know, I think about the need for educators in respect to what you might think of as the four R's. We've already talked a little bit about representation, seeing yourself in the work that you're doing, in the books, in the materials, et cetera. Getting my own three African-American students through school as children, you know, that was so important for them and rare to be able to find that hook. But we also need to have an attitude of respect. So that's sort of the framework for everything. And you know, we've seen these horrific videotapes of young Black students being, you know, beaten in schools by security guards, you know, being thrown to the ground, you know, all kinds of horrible, you know, for being on a cell phone or for, you know, saying something in a tone that somebody took the wrong way. So developing a framework for respect is like a foundation that everyone needs to be thinking about and working on in a variety of ways. Relevance is another piece. Kids have to see how what we're doing in classrooms is relevant and draws on their experience and includes their experience in a variety of ways. And then, you know, there's the relationship side of it. And when I, you know, I have been involved in teacher education for a long time, and I've thought a lot about how do you create that framework for students. It's partly what happens in the teacher education program itself, that you create awareness of the issues. In our program, first of all, we moved very quickly when we redesigned it to be sure that more than half of the students in California, as is true of our student population, half of our candidates are students of color, candidates of color, who can work in collaboration to help each other understand a broader set of experiences. And it's very important in schools, too, that we have that collaborative space with a diverse teaching population where people can share with each other. But the other thing that we did, we planted a social justice flag throughout the program. Equity is in the very first set of courses. We carry it through every other course. Awareness of the kids we teach and where they come from and what they bring has to be part of everything teachers are thinking about. And then where they go to student teach has to represent a place where that respect, representation, and relationship is in place. We stopped placing student teachers in schools that were inequitable, and we actually had to start some schools to be in relationship with us because so many of the schools in our area, high schools, were tracked by color and caste in a context where there were assumptions about who could do high quality work and who would not have that opportunity. And we decided we could not send prospective professionals into those environments as a way to learn what the profession is about and what the children they're going to teach is about.
Yeah, two points, and then Dr. Ali, I want to ask you to talk about the work of making the R, the relevant piece, connected. Some of us were together 2 weeks ago in Dallas at the NEA Summit, and one of the things that I thought was really powerful is that somebody shared as a new rule that they were no longer going to ask the question, what's wrong with you, and just ask what's wrong. Right, and when making assumptions about students, always start with the best of intentions and assumptions rather than starting with that which we might otherwise naturally want to perceive about a student. But you mentioned, and I want to spend a little bit of time here, what happened to the young girl in South Carolina who was at a desk on her phone the day after her mother passed, right, and was asked to get off her phone by an instructor who then called in support. You're the teacher? Okay. So we're just going to ground us a little bit. My question is actually to our students, and for those who haven't seen it, we'll talk a little bit more about it, but it's also on YouTube. But a young girl was essentially flipped out of her chair by a grown man, right? And for whatever reason, there isn't one, but let's just leave it there. As students, when things like that happen, how does that make you feel?
It makes me feel disappointed that I feel like they made the assumption that she was going to try and do something bad because she's black. And I feel like that's really disappointing. It doesn't happen in my school, but I know that it will happen in other places, and it makes me sad.
And why do you say it doesn't happen in my school with such certainty?
Well, I say that doesn't happen in my school because, well, my campaign is kind of open diversity more to my school, so I don't think that would have happened, but either way, because we're pretty open to each other and we don't really judge or make assumptions off of our race and our gender, but if that were to happen, I would have felt really disappointed in my school and any other community that makes assumptions based on because I look black, even if I wasn't black.
I love that. I love that you identify that you have worked to ensure that there's a community at their school that wouldn't tolerate that, right?
Yeah.
She should be applauded for that.
Yes, she should.
Maria, same question to you. When things like that happen and or we have these moments where as a nation we pause to mourn the literal loss of a life, how does that make you feel?
Well, relating back to what Marley said, I think it would be the same thing at my school. I don't think something like that would happen at my school, and if something like that was to happen, then there would be our program, the Minority Scholars Program, would just finish that, shut that down really quick. Like, it wouldn't go any farther than that, and that would be really sad, and it would make me disappointed, but at the same time, I think it would start a discussion. It would start a discussion once again that is really important for people to listen to and open people's eyes.
So you guys clapped, and what I think about is that there's power in precision, right? And how different would our classrooms and our schools and our communities be if we all would shut down those moments when kids are made to feel like they're not enough, right, for whatever reason. And if these young, brilliant people can do it at the time when we're most acceptable to peer pressure and being judged and feeling insecure about who we are, then certainly we can do it. Right. Dr. Ali, can you talk a little bit about the center's work and how it is that you're working to support educators in all ways, shapes, and forms to make all of what these young people are asking for and working to accomplish and what Linda spoke to real?
Yeah, absolutely. One of our main priorities is supporting teachers to have healthier and more productive conversations about race and to acknowledge that race and racism have an impact on who they are and who their students are. So one of the most important aspects of cultural competence is not knowing about your students' cultures, but knowing about your own culture. And I want to speak from the perspective of where we find ourselves in education, that 85% of our teachers are white. And I grew up, I'm white, I grew up in a community that was predominantly white, where I was taught to be a good person, I should be colorblind. I should not think about race, I should not talk about race. And I also really, I lived in a segregated community. And what we find is that this is actually the experience of a lot of white teachers, that a lot of people grew up thinking that to be good, I should be colorblind, I shouldn't notice race, I shouldn't talk about it. And as a result, living in the society that we live in, we get some pretty crazy messages about African American communities. And when we're being colorblind, when we're not talking about race or racism, or we're afraid of that conversation, then those messages sink in. So some of the messages I got about African American students, about African American communities, that they're not intelligent, that they're dangerous, and strangely, that they're exactly like us. So, you know, we get these like negative deficit messages, and then we get the idea that we're all the same. Actually, we're all the same. And so I don't know about you, but I've never been able to learn from somebody who fears me or who pities me or who assumes that the way they do things is better than the way that I do things or the way that my community does things. And so a culturally competent teacher, particularly for a white teacher, I think involves somebody who understands the role that whiteness has played in their lives. And that's part of our work at the center, is to support teachers to start to see that without guilt, but with a sense of agency, that understanding myself and my community and the messages that I've been taught is going to help me better see my students. A culturally competent teacher would not be colorblind, see the role that race and racism plays in their lives, would understand that bias is a natural and normal human phenomenon, that everybody has it, and that we need to work to be conscious of our bias so that it doesn't get in the way of our relationships. And thirdly, a culturally competent educator is building relationships, not based on fear, not based on pity or a sense of internalized superiority, but on authentic connection across race. And that's part of what we're trying to foster at the center.
And I think one thing that's really important to being able to do all of those things is to ground everything in facts. And so it really bothers me that we continue to say things that are just factually inaccurate, mm-hmm. like there are more black men in prison than in college, mm-hmm. or that black people are lazy when help to contribute to building the foundations of this country. If we would only use data that exists, right, in multiple places, all of these individuals are connected to centers that provide that data. The U.S. Department of Education has the Office of Civil Rights that has put a lot of numbers behind the assumptions that many people have. But if we grounded things in fact and in truth, it would help us to accomplish all of those things that Dr. Ali spoke about. Renee, can you talk a bit about the work of teaching tolerance and how it is that you're working to help to connect these dots as well?
Okay. And that was a misprint, actually, teaching tolerance.
Okay. The Delta Writing Project.
Keep going. I work with something called the Teacher Leadership Initiative.
Okay, tell us about that.
Teacher Leadership Initiative. Thank you all for clarifying that for me. Teacher Leadership Initiative is a collaboration between the National Board, the NEA, and the Center for Teaching Quality. And it's a project designed to encourage leadership, to develop teacher leaders. And in that project, one of the things that we're doing is preparing teachers to our leaders to be culturally competent. And I was listening as Linda was speaking, because those schools, those unequal schools that she won't send her student teachers to, that's where I live, okay? I teach in Mississippi in the Delta. And we have many, many teachers out in schools who are working with diverse student populations who have had no preparation in multicultural education, have had no preparation in how to deal with diverse cultures. And that's where they are. And how do we move them into a level of cultural competency so that they can actually teach students? The way to do that for those who are already in the field, we think, is to prepare teachers who are already leaders to go back into their schools and into their districts with those skills and to share them in turn to by example, first of all, but then to share them with their colleagues and coworkers. And that's easier said than done, because we're having to come against a lot of these misconceptions and misteachings. Being colorblind, you know, a lot of teachers think that's a good thing, or they've bought into the deficit view of our students. But that not only exists between teachers and students, that exists between teachers and teachers. It exists within the profession. So pedagogical expertise, the cultural competence of African American teachers has been undervalued historically within our education system as well. African American teachers have been marginalized. Our voices have been silenced.
Right.
So how do you learn to become a culturally competent teacher if you're not even practicing that within the profession?
Right.
So it's a two-sided battle that
we're fighting. So unpack very quickly, and then we'll go to bring Jose into the conversation, how we do that. What are the things that are required, are the first steps that we need to take in order to make real that which you just described?
The first step, particularly for those of us who are already in the field, because teacher education, thank God, is slowly changing. But for those of us who are already in the field, who are already practicing, one way is by looking to the standards. I'm talking about the National Board standards now. Because in the 25 certificate areas of National Board, every one of those standards addresses diversity, equity, and social justice in some detail. So in order to become a highly accomplished teacher, one has to demonstrate the ability to attend to those issues. And it's quite powerful. Many teachers, everyone who's been through the National Board process talks about how that process has changed our teaching. And one of the ways it can change your teaching is by teaching you and showing you what cultural competence looks like in a classroom. Another way we can change it is by elevating the voices of diverse teachers within the teaching profession. We don't have enough teachers of color, because so many tens of thousands of teachers of color have been run out of the profession, and we've never acknowledged that. Many of them have been silenced. We still have policies in place that make it difficult for black and Latino teachers to even get into the profession. So you can't We have a lot of work we could do to change the way we do schooling and to change the profession. And once we change the profession, then we can change how we teach the children.
You about to get some stuff started. I hear what y'all saying. That's a whole nother panel. We got some time. We'll go there. One more thing before we move on this. How do we know what a culturally competent, culturally responsive classroom looks like? What does it feel like? What does it look like in practical terms?
In my own classroom, because that's what I do every day, I teach people English. I've been doing it for 27 years. You get to know your students, first of all. You get to know your students, you get to know your community, you get to know your subject, and you know how to teach that subject to those specific students. So that's the first rule, is to get to know the students and to know yourself and know where you meet. I'm a black woman. I've always taught in 100%, 99% African-American schools, but I'm not originally from Mississippi. I married into Mississippi. So when I got there.
Y'all know what that means.
Yeah. they brought me down there. But
how it happens most often?
Yes, I am. When I got there, though, I'd started my teaching career in Mississippi. I've always taught in Mississippi. But I was mentored into the profession by a group of amazing veteran African-American teachers. And I spent hours and hours watching them and listening to them. Today, very few teachers get that kind of mentoring from teachers of color. And they taught me how to teach Delta children. So in a culturally competent classroom, one of the things you see is a lot of exchange, a lot of learning about the students, a lot of the teacher learning about the students, as well as the students learning from the teacher. And you see teachers learning from other teachers, particularly from veteran teachers, who pass that cultural knowledge on. And those are some things you can't teach in teacher ed program. Those are things you have to learn in the building, in the community where you're going to be teaching. You have to learn the community.
Perfect way.
Can I just say, you can learn, however, in teacher ed, how to, in your full year of student teaching, if that's what you're getting, which was what we do, how to do that in whatever context you're in and know that you have to carry that to another context. We talk about pedagogical content knowledge, but there's pedagogical learner knowledge, and that's what you're talking about, that you learn how to have a two-way pedagogy where your first job is to learn who the students are, exactly, what they think, what they care about, where they come from. That's what you ground your curriculum and your planning in. And so, yes, then you have to learn when you get to Mississippi, if that's where you go, you have to get, hopefully you get Renee and her colleagues to help you learn that community. But you have to go into it knowing that I'm learning this in every place that I teach, for every group of students that I teach. And you have to have some tools for doing that.
It's the idea that we should not overcomplicate things, right? Everything you ever needed to know, you learned in kindergarten, and the idea that people care first, that you care about them before they care about that which you know, is at the core of what we're talking about. And the thread that runs through what everybody has said is the importance of community, right, in every way, shape, or form. And so, Jose, will you sort of ground the work of EduColor and how it is that we engage the community in this work?
So, thank you. What I'd say is this. We had a problem, and this came from a whole bunch of teachers who excellent all throughout, many of them who are actually National Board certified. And there was a problem, which is how do we start the critical conversations in our classroom? And specifically, how do we talk about race, class, and gender? Oftentimes, the criticism on, you know, on social media, whether it be Twitter, Facebook, wherever, was, oh, these conversations are really too hard to have in our with our students, with the rest of our staff, et cetera, et cetera. And so EduColor came in to the conversation saying, this is how you do it. We started off by building off a curriculum for Jordan Davis when he was murdered. And then we started to see, of course, the wellspring of other black and Latino children being murdered. Ayanna Jones-Daly, Tamir Rice, Mike Brown, school-age children. And the idea that not just black educators, but white educators, Latino educators, were all seeing their children reflected in these murders. And so, in times of tragedy, in times of trauma, we said we need to step up in a very big way. We need to be that plug and find a way to really talk about these conversations in a critical fashion. So when we talk about community, there's two communities at this juncture. We have the online community and we have the offline community. And really, we build that online community real quickly. We said, okay, let's get a hashtag together, hashtag EduColor, and let's have a monthly conversation, town hall style, and people can come in and talk about whatever it is they wish, and then we'll just build from there. We'll build the conversations and we'll try to push people to think more critically about what's going on in their world. Not just white educators, but educators of color as well, because the incident that happened at Springfield High School happened with a black male educator in front, with a black principal, and then with a white cop. And these are things that we need to talk about when it comes to cultural competence too, right? Like, all of us need it, because all of us need to find a way to de-emphasize the punishment that a lot of us take on when we become educators. We don't need to be as authoritarian as we think we do when the kids can be more empowered and we can cultivate that power. So when you have that online conversation, it kind of gives people a way to say, okay, let's have a conversation offline now, and let's empower people offline. Like, how are you gonna take that into your classroom and not necessarily throw kids out the classroom whenever you feel disgruntled, or not feel like you're very uncomfortable in front of all these kids who look so different from you or have a different culture from you? How do you actually talk to other, to policymakers even? Like, how do you talk to your own people, your higher ed professors, anybody, about these conversations, because they're so critical to cultural competence? And, you know, I agree with everyone on this panel in that there is this idea of building a community of folks who really want to do this work. And if you're really willing to do the work, then you are part of EduColor as well. It's just all a matter of how do you build that out, and how do we have that critical lens towards that work?
So let's answer one of those questions in like the length of a tweet. How do those of us who are uncomfortable standing in the space of difficult discussions start? What do we do in our classrooms?
Step number one. I'm trying to go on the 140 characters.
Yes, that is a part of it.
Step number one, decenter yourself and center the children.
Awesome. So I have one more question. One more question to Professor Dolly Hammond, and then I'll give you my rules of engagement. And it's simply this: what happens to students who show up to schools not really fully knowing who they are and whose they are, and don't have the types of classrooms that you're working to support, or that Renee or all the other panelists are working to create for our students? What's the consequence of not doing this and doing it right?
We see it all the time. I mean, the consequence is everything from being marginalized or marginalizing oneself in the corners of the classroom and trying to hide out and not, you know, engaging and feeling part of. And that, you know, that's one whole phenomenon that can lead you to dropping out and not succeeding, to, you know, feeling like school is a threat, because school is threatening to children much of the time. Think about all the rules and the consequences and, you know, the sort of punishments that get meted out and that then disproportionately get meted out. So school can become perceived as a threatening place. And of course you want to avoid. We all as human beings have a fight or flight syndrome. And if you feel like you're being threatened, if you feel like someone disrespects you or doesn't care about you or sees you as less than, you know, you're going to react. I mean, that is just the way human nature is. As you were talking, Jose, I was thinking about how important it is for all of us to be thinking about ways that we understand child development. Jim Comer has talked about this for years, building these school environments where everyone understands that children are developing and learning, and the way that we all create common ways of interacting and working together is by explicitly teaching and reaching each other, rather than this whole idea that it's about, I do this and these are my rules, and if you violate my rules, I have 15 ways to make you excluded. That is too much of the framework, and then we know the result of that is that, in fact, kids are excluded. And eventually, any sane person will say, I'm no longer doing this. I'm not, as soon as I can not come.
Or they'll fight back.
Literally or figuratively.
Yeah.
So let's do this. We have about 20 minutes left. If we could turn the lights up just a little bit so I can see all these fancy, beautiful, brilliant people. Are there mics in the audience? Yes? Okay, so if you have a question, please walk up to the mic. Notice I use the word I didn't say statement. I didn't say soliloquy. I didn't say poem. I said question usually begins with what? Who, what, where, when, why, or how. It should be a question. I'm emphasizing this because there are a number of you in line, and I want to try and manage all of our expectations. So if you do not ask a question, I will cut you off with love.
Yes, you will.
All right, and we're also going to try and direct the questions to a particular panelist. We'll start with you, sir.
Thank you. Stephen Cody, Prince George's County Schools, Maryland. My question is, what can what can schools and school districts do to recruit and retain more black teachers?
Who feels particularly compelled to answer that?
Okay.
Black male teachers, I'm sorry.
First,
more
please.
Black male teachers.
One way we can recruit more black teachers is by treating the black teachers who are already there with more respect. Because our young people look at us and they say, well, why would I want to put myself in the position that you're in? I have a lot of former students who are now teaching who are also administrators. And one of the things they constantly say is that I wanted to do it because I saw, you know, what you did and what other people did. But when they see black teachers or teachers of color being disrespected and removed, first ones kicked out of the door, being blamed for everything that's wrong, not given the assignments to teach the honors classes or the advanced courses, they see that. They're not crazy. Why would I want to do that? So that's one thing we could do.
Yes, sir, your question? Keep talking, I'll pick it up.
Fairfax County Public Schools. What are some of the stories or examples that you have of learning to teach in a culture of students that was new? What are some of the successes and what are some of the failures?
Professor Abbott, why don't you take that one?
Learning to teach in a culture of students where you are newly learning that culture?
Yes.
Yes. Well, one of the first things is, you know, and I see this all the time, teachers having a lot of tools where they can come in and start the school year asking students to journal about things that, you know, how do you see yourself as a learner? What do you want to learn in this class? Tell me about what you bring to the class. Of doing home visits. We teach our student teachers to visit either at the home or the school with the parents right away. Positive phone calls home so that you start a dialogue with the parents as partners as well as the students telling you about how they learn and what they bring. So the whole beginning of school is about you are the important people here. Let's learn about what we can bring together. And then we bring the content into that and hook the content onto the cultural and experiential basis of the students. And, you know, in a lot of schools, you're going to teach kids who have 52 different languages. I mean, I'm in the San Francisco area. You're going to have a lot of cultures to learn and a lot of contexts and experiences. You need to know and have a lot of tools to do the work of learning who the students are and what they can contribute. And then having ways for the ones who are sitting in the margins to one-on-one with them and bring them out of what might be, you know, a place where they're quietly hiding as well. And the other piece of that is having long-term relationships between adults and children. We adopted the prescient age grading system in this country. Every kid gets another teacher every year, and they get another, you know, teacher every 45 minutes in high school and middle school. Many countries have the same teacher with the same kids for 2, 3, even up to 6 or 8 years. And we see the results of that in growing achievement. There's a lot of research on the fact that looping with kids, having an advisor in the middle and high school who stays with the kids, mm-hmm. a group of kids for a period of time, part of it is having those relationships that deepen over time so that you really can be there when the kids have whatever need it is, and they know that there is an adult in that school who is there for them.
We should all have that. Yes, ma'am, your question.
Hi, Casey Wilcox. I teach Jefferson County Public Schools in Louisville, Kentucky. I have a lot of young black men in my school who their only role models are athletes or musicians that they see on TV. But how do I give them a role model that sees that as a way towards maybe a higher education that
yep.
may put them in a different spot other than, you know, I'm not going to necessarily be an athlete whenever
yep,
I'm
got
at
it.
School.
Jose, why don't you start, and then Marley, why don't you supplement?
I think, I don't know your specific situation, but I'm always concerned about this idea that black males only have certain role models, because in fact, I think a lot of us do have role models, we just don't speak about them all the time. So, you know, LeBron James is a real good player, but he doesn't inform the opinion of a lot of my students, even though they love him. In fact, some of them have fathers, they have people who they look up to already in the community. It just so happens they don't always talk about them. So I think one of the ways that we can do that work is actually just being a regular old person, like just be cool. I mean, some of the things that we don't talk about is how do we like actually be cool with people? Like, how do we work with our children and not necessarily punish them and test them all the time? And that's really that's the issue there. Is like, let's talk about, ask them, like, just ask them, like, what do you actually need from me for me to help you see alternative pathways and open up those pathways for you? And of course, you could do that through the content, but you should also be doing that through your own personality and the way that you know the students.
Marley, what's your advice?
My advice is, as you as a teacher, you can introduce that to them because they think of you, they see you every day, they want to learn from you. You create the relationship, and if they're not getting anything from you, they're going to turn off from you in general, not like you as a teacher, if you're not trying to make them more successful in the long term by giving them an example that doesn't, like, I'm not saying like to turn down basketball players, like something that they like more realistic as to like a corporate job or anything like that they might want to do that's not a musician or an athlete.
All right, so I want to, again, we talk about managing expectations being really important. We have less than 20 minutes and there are more than 10 people in line. Oh. So if y'all talk for more than a minute and they respond for more than a minute, we will not have what? Enough time. So we need to keep it brief. That includes the clapping. We're going to take 2 questions and then let them respond. Ma'am, what's your question?
Hi, I'm Livia Doman from Fairfax County. I teach art. I'm curious about best practices for training new and veteran teachers in cultural competency.
Perfect. And your question?
I wanted to ask the 2 students on the panel about when we live in a culture of racial distrust, what ways can a white teacher build better relationships with students of color?
Awesome. And your question?
How do you suggest centering our students in love rather than in a punitive way?
Awesome. So we have 3 questions. Why don't you take the question of best practices? You guys can respond to. You want to take the last one? You got it, girl. Okay. Why don't you go? Let me get out your way. Go ahead.
Okay. Well, the first thing is to not think of being black as like the black experience or the Latino experience. It's black experiences, and we're not all the same. So yeah. That was my answer.
I love it. Okay. Best practices?
Well, I think that's a good starting point for best practices is to realize that you want to understand your students as individuals. It's not like there's some cultural competency course that says, oh, and this is how black people are, and this is how Latino people are. I mean, there used to be that like really simplistic idea that somehow you would just like create stereotypes and teach them to teachers, and that would be cultural training. It's all about understanding who people are, having a toolkit of practices that are allow people to learn in a variety of ways, have a range of instructional practices. Start with that presumption of love. Start with the presumption that every student can achieve, and then you have a lot of different ways to help them do that. And it's being aware of the racial and racist contexts within which we all have to operate so that you're mindful of the ways that you don't reinforce the stereotype threat that may be on the table and things like that. And then I think there's this whole business about sort of restorative justice approach or a positive approach to the learning of interaction and behavior that is takes us past the punitive place that we have been in this country. And teachers need tools to not send the kid out of the class, but to say, let's talk about that. Hey, we need a little conversation
here. Let's manage it here.
And that's at part of the heart.
Again, Asa Hilliard said it best when he said, I've never met a child, in particular a child of color, who is not a genius, and there's no secret to how we support them. The first thing we do is to meet them with love. Right, so thank you for responding to 2 questions in 1. Yes, ma'am.
I teach at an international school, and I'm curious what the panel would say to my students who are fearful of coming to university in the United States based on what they see in the news. Mm. They're looking at schools in Canada and Europe. what would you tell them? And quite frankly, as an American, I would be very proud to have these students here at American universities, but they're fearful.
Fearful. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Leanne Stevens, racial equity coach, St. Louis Park Schools, St. Louis Park, Minnesota. My question is, how do we stop defining our black boys, the success of our black boys, by their behavior and not by their academic prowess?
Perfect question. Yes, ma'am, your question.
What are some suggested strategies for bringing about awareness for lack of diversity and inequity in education?
Would you take the last one?
I'll try. One way to bring about better knowledge of the inequity is to bring the conversation to more people. A lot of what goes on in schools is hidden to people. If you're not a parent, and you know, parents only get a partial view, really, of what's going on a lot of times in our schools. Teachers, we need to make more noise. We need to make it more clear to a broader section of the community what's really going on in our schools, what's really happening with students, what's really happening with teachers. And the more we make that discussion public, then the more the public can help us to change the nature of the school. So that's one thing.
The second question about black boys?
One thing I do in my classroom is whenever somebody does something, I actually take the 2 or 3 seconds and try to understand where that comes from. Mm. And I ask myself, and I'm reflective of what the action was and where it's stemming from. And then I take the next 5 seconds to say, okay, this is what's happening. And then let me have that conversation with the student. I pull them outside and then I say, so what's going on? I give them their piece. I let them say what they need to say. And sometimes it's not gonna come out right, but then when it comes out, it's like, okay, so now that we got through that, what are the expectations in our classroom? What are we actually doing in the class? How are we supposed to approach this? And then give them some seat time to really think about what they've done and then come back into what's going on. So just off that, I've limited the amount of times I've had to send kids out to the class. I could have gone to like the dean 30 different times, and instead I've only done it once all year. So that's something that already works for me. But if it works for you, I'm happy for you.
The converse of that is that we also can focus on the positive things that boys right. and men of color do outside of dribbling balls and singing songs. Yeah. Right? So we can do things like tell stories like those of Marley's, right? And how young people are literally changing communities, challenging hearts, and challenging minds. But we also acknowledge that in spite of the fact that black men and boys are overrepresented in prison, there are still 700,000 more of them on college campuses to this day. In spite of the lies that they'll tell about how we show up in the world or don't show up, we still look fly on the corner and in the White House, right? Like, and everywhere in between, right? Would you take the question, either of you, about the international context and what you would say to students who are fearful about the context here?
I was confused about that question. What are they afraid of?
And then there's that, but no. Did you understand that I want to speak to it?
I could only imagine. I wasn't sure what they're afraid of. We, you know, it's a good place. Come on.
Celebrate the asset.
But I do want to say something about academic prowess.
Yep.
One of the other things that's culturally competent teaching is noticing what students, all students, are accomplishing, thinking, doing that is academically solid, and playing that back to them. Every teacher should have kind of a list of all the things that they want to be sure that they're playing back to kids, whether it's a note on the paper or a comment in the class about the successes they have had. Every paper should be, how many things did you do well here? What shows you're learning, rather than how many things did you do wrong? And then you build success on more success, and here's what you can do to improve this. And that recognizes the academic prowess and builds the academic prowess that otherwise sometimes is just ignored.
We can do the same thing too. Instead of talking about what Donald Trump is saying about the world, we can highlight the positive things going on in our country. Yes, ma'am.
My question is for Jose, if you could expand upon when you said decenter yourself and censor.
Decenter, yep, let's see if you can do that. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
What specific strategies do you recommend for providing a multicultural view for students when they live in a white, middle, lower class situation?
Good one. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I run a computer science program, and we all know that this is an area in which students of color are largely underrepresented. I was curious of what's your take of, you spoke of role models. How do you feel about connecting students to role models on a college level, from high school to college, to make them more receptive and more inspired to learn more computer science?
Who feels compelled to take the last one? Yes.
Because I teach high school and community college. So I spend a lot of time connecting my students across grade levels, across ranges, which is something that's really good for students and teachers to do. And it is a good idea, but there's more resources out there than just the direct connection between colleges. You can use the digital tools to connect the students. I have my students, my college students and my high school students often do projects together online. They'll do different types of digital work together. But there's another step you can do, and I've used this in my classroom very successfully, and it speaks to some of the other questions that people have raised. I've asked my students to identify in their life a significant adult, someone who they respect, whom they respect, and who they believes in them, and in their ability to get an education, and identify that person to me. It can be their parent, but it doesn't have to be. And I, in turn, network with those people all throughout the school year. And a lot of those people are people who have skills in many different areas and who bring cultural knowledge to me and to the classroom. And we work together as a team to build a support network for my students. And it has been very, very successful. I've done it many, many times over years. And it's a good resource to reach out to. You'll be surprised, the people who are out there in your community and the skills that they have, and that when the students themselves pick those people, it becomes much more powerful and impactful to them, and they'll listen to them.
What about doing this work in perceived spaces of privilege?
I think that's such an important question about how to teach white students about race, because I feel like all of the things that we've been talking about applies to white students as well. Part of developing an anti-racist pedagogy is, or a multiculturally competent pedagogy, is to create more whole communities that are less damaged by racism. And in that way, you know, having male role models who are not just basketball players or musicians is important for white students too. So I like to think about it that our work as teachers is to support the positive racial identity development of all students. And so what does that look like if you're working with white students? Having them have a positive racial identity doesn't mean they feel good about being white just because they're white. It also doesn't mean that they feel bad about being white. They feel guilty about being white just for being white. Having a positive racial identity for white people means that you have an accurate understanding of what it means to be white in our society, about how racism has impacted your life and the lives of people in your community, that you're not deceived about having, you know, an internalized sense of superiority or being better for being white, and that you take an active stance against racism and use privilege to work against racism. So I feel like that's part of our goal as teachers, is to support positive racial identity development in all of our students. And all of the things we're doing here, talking about here, will be useful to white students. The most important thing for white students is that they have anti-racist white teachers to model what does it look like to be a white person who takes a stand against racism and who actively works against the way that we are differentiated and stereotyped and marginalized by race.
So I know Professor Darling Hammond wants to, y'all can, yep, right, uh-huh. Professor Darling Hammond wants to speak. We're gonna take these last two questions and then we're gonna land this plane. But before we do that, Rodney, I see a tweet, brother, music educator who also played basketball. I also have a friend who works at the NBA Players Association. So I want to be clear in that we are not and should not ever beat up on basketball players.
Beat up on the basketball players.
In fact, we should honor and celebrate that they show up in significant ways that are often not talked about, right? We sometimes tell lies about all basketball players, in particular the black ones, that would suggest that they don't have fathers, that they're not fathers to their children, that they don't show up in ways that are also meaningful. And to the earlier question about how you use that as an anchor, remind folks that they didn't get to the NBA until they went to college. And to get to college at the D1 schools that they played at, they had to have a certain GPA, right? And to show how we back that up, this Department of Education has also done work to ensure that the college athletic association increases the expectations they have for student athletes, right? That's how we connect dots in ways that are meaningful for students, LDH.
I just wanted to add to this question about how do we create multicultural knowledge base for white teachers who've grown up in a white context. Very important to handhold that process of coming into the student teaching placement if you're in a college setting that full year in places that are multicultural contexts where good practices are going on, where anti-racist practices are going on, where equitable practices are going on, and handhold the learning and thinking and reflecting process for the teachers as they're figuring out how to be an agent for positive change in that space.
rather than just throwing, as many colleges do, unfortunately, throwing people into diverse settings, right, with sink or swim, where bad role modeling is going on and not actually enabling a learning process. So that's part of the challenge.
Before, I know Jose's hand as well, but we only talked a second about the part of the community that's most essential, and that's the fact that our parents are our first and most important educators. And Marley, I know your mama's in the back, and that's my friend. So can y'all talk about the role of parents in all of this, and how it is that we should either honor and or support parents in ensuring that we, as people, know who we are and whose we are? Why don't you start, and then you can conclude.
Okay, well, my parents are both professionals, so that's a good start, because that's just a good role model for my parents. But also, my mom, over there in the crowd.
Hey, mama.
Hey, mom.
Stand up, mama.
Stand up. From the beginning, the biggest thing that I've always gotten off is my mom has always let me just wander and never really set a boundary for me. So we've moved all around the place. We moved from Honduras, in the fifth grade, and I lived in New York for a little bit, then I moved to the Bethesda area. So I've been all around the place, but my mom has always kind of nurtured that open-mindedness in my mind. So because of that, I feel like I'm way more open. I'm just embraced different, because that's a thing that we do wrong often. We as humans tend to push away what's different, and that's the result. And that's because of that, there's so many problems based on that. Just those judgments, just those things that we think, oh, it's different, I don't want it. But differences are good. That's the biggest thing that we need to
say that again.
Differences are good. So just having parents that are open-minded, parents that are not telling you, oh, why are you hanging out with that friend? Maybe because it's different, maybe because they don't know about it. That's just the biggest impact that I've had.
Stop saying to kids don't do things because you're afraid of it. Yes, ma'am.
One of the things that my mom's always said to me is okay, you can make as many mistakes as you want, you just can't make them. Oh.
Keep going.
Over again. She'll let me mess up and try again, but I'm not allowed to repeat my mistakes. I always have to keep going and try something new instead of being okay, I messed up. I wasn't sharing that. I can't do that again. I just have to keep going and keep moving forward.
Love that. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I know I'm going to start with you, Jose, because you want to get on the last one.
To my sister from Honduras, I'm so proud of you. So the question is, how you got started, why, and what inspires you?
And so yes, sir, your question?
Matthew Teeter, Harvard Graduate School of Education. I'm MBCT as well. I'm going to be a school principal next year, and I'd like to know what the role of principal is in this work, the ideal role for you guys.
So let's start with that one. Jose, do you want to comment on either of those, or you want to go back to the last one?
I want to go back to the decentering one, specifically because when you talk about decentering, we're talking about, yes, educators are experts, but we do not have to be the center of everything that goes on in the classroom. In fact, we should encourage students to take on that ownership. I mean, when we talk about decentering, I mean, do you address your students as, oh, she's a one, he's a two? Or do you address them as, this person knows what they're talking about in this? Do we address them in terms of saying, oh, this person got the wrong answer, or we can never hear from them again? Or do you say, oh, you're kind of approaching the answer, I want to hear more about how you approach that answer? When you change your dialogue and you go from deficit language to actual positive reaffirming language, you're basically telling the students, you are welcome in my class, you belong in my class. And that's why when I say decentering, we as adults oftentimes think we have to be the center of everything, and we don't. In fact, I encourage everyone to let it go. It's okay. The kids are going to be, as far as the parents are concerned, our kids are going to be all right. We don't need to be the center of everything. They will be fine, and they'll be better without us in some cases if we don't let go of that control and that power. And that's really what I'm trying to get at there.
Hashtag let it go.
Let it go.
And again, let's not overcomplicate. There's one among you who I met after the screening of He Named Me Malala, who is operating a course that was designed by students. I'm looking to see if she will identify. Right here, stand up, young lady. Right? And so whoever asked that question about decentering also talk about her, right? As I understand it, her students proposed what it is that they wanted to see in a class, and it wasn't pizza at a party, and the stuff that we sometimes flippantly say students would ask, well, they wanted to know about community service, right? Ways to connect their learning to practical application in the community around them, and they have the love and support of educators, including these two women here, who help them to make the course that they designed a reality, right? That's an example of decentering, putting the students at the center and honoring what it is that they need. Thank you for all that you do. The question about principals, leaders, what's our goals, expectations? Let's do 1, 2.
The principals I've worked with who are most effective are making sure that their faculty know that cultural competency is a value for them. They provide lots of opportunities for teachers to opt in at the place where, you know, so that they can start and learn from where they are. So they create a lot of learning opportunities. They don't make it high stakes because they want people to be honest. They want them to be conducting their own growth, engaged in their own growth, but they do demonstrate to teachers that this is, that cultural competency is something that they will be evaluated on, and they hire for cultural competency. So they don't just assume that people will get it when they're on the job, but that they, when they say this is something that we value and we're going to hire people who are either culturally competent or who are willing to be a part of a community where we expect a high level of cultural competency from every person, and if they don't have it, they're willing to get it as they're working.
When I go into a school, as I have for many years, both in teaching and teacher education and for my own kids, I want to see a school where there are representations of all kinds of people on the walls, where all of the different activities have equal status in the school. I want to see a school where kids of different backgrounds are learning in classrooms together, not in a tracked, color-coded environment. I want to see a school where the environment is supporting a positive approach to responsibility learning rather than punishment, as what they call discipline. All of that is in the hands of the principal. I want the teachers to be able to and learn to use a wide repertoire of practices that are responsive to the different kids that they teach, and have a frame of reference which says, this is about you belonging in our school, each of the children, and building a community for that. All of that is the agenda for the teacher leaders and the principal in that school.
I have your question in my pocket. I'm going to answer it. You're going to get the very last question. Yep.
All right, my name is Jeriel Champion. I'm a math teacher from Richmond, Virginia. And my question is, when we talk about cultural competency, does that include sexual orientation?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It includes everything. Yes.
Yes.
Short answer is yes. Does anybody want to say anything specific to that? We do sometimes have this conversation and only focus on race or ethnicity. But somebody want to speak more about intersectionality more general? Yes.
It is absolutely a part of the conversation. And as every classroom teacher knows, dealing with those issues in the classroom can make or break a classroom, a setting. It can turn a child's life completely around. We have a responsibility to make the classroom a safe learning environment for all of our students. Yep. And for teachers. It's also a conversation within the profession that we need to have.
Yeah, and I just want to highlight that our commission, which Peggy Brookins sits on, along with James Comer, who was mentioned as well, is really focusing to make recommendations to the president and the administration around 4 core areas. And in addition to that, those are just increasing access to high quality early learning, increasing success in accessing STEM or STEAM, acknowledging the importance of art or agriculture, accelerating post-secondary success specifically by reducing the need for and time spent in developmental ed, which is where a significant number of minorities get tripped up, and then connecting with students who are not in the pipeline. In addition to that, they are focusing on highlighting the unique needs of members of our community that often get overlooked. So in June, we will be hosting a White House summit on African-American students who are LGBTQI. Right, in July, we'll be hosting a White House summit on African-American students and leaders with disabilities. Right, I offer that as examples to say that we have to acknowledge that all of those parts of our children make them who they are as whole people. And if we don't acknowledge that and address it, we will continue to do them a disservice. And so we're going to give that gentleman's question to both of you. And the question is, how did you become so brilliant? How did you get started?
Who's going first?
You go first, and then you can win.
Okay, well, first of all, I did not move to this country for nothing. They call this country the land of opportunity, so I'm going to take advantage of those opportunities that are set there for me. I also attend school in Montgomery County, and that's one of the best education, like education-wise, that's one of the best counties. So
I'm going to take advantage of that. I'm going to look at those opportunities, like just being here right now. This is an opportunity for me right now, and I'm taking it with no hesitation. I'm gonna make the best out of it. So another thing is that I've been told to be the positive change I want to be. And that's just something that's pushed me so far because I just want to see a change. I'm a Black Latino student. If I can do it, then anybody else can. Just take that potential, that everybody has that potential. Some people just have to discover it within themselves.
So to the person who asked the question about what to say to people that have questions about coming here from an international context, run that tape back. Show them exactly what she said. Young Marley?
Well, I think there's two things that really made me the way I am now is the fact that I know who I am, and I know that I can use my gifts and talents to change the world, but I'm not the only person who has those gifts and talents, so that I can use mine, but it's not like I'm the only person who can be smart and be Black and be a girl, because I feel like that makes you the center of attention if you think you're always the center.
Yeah, go, go.
But I have to understand that I can change the world, but so can everybody else.
So I want to first say thank you to these brilliant and beautiful panelists who made my job incredibly easy. I want to thank all of you again for not only doing God's work, but for adhering to my rules. And I want to thank you for the work that you will continue to do. And I'm going to ask that as you do that, you continue to take care of yourselves and each other. Right? I'm certain that the work you will continue to do and that the work required to implement that which we've talked about today is not easy. Some of you will go back to classrooms and school systems and spaces where you will be challenged in wanting to do this work, sometimes by people who look just like you. Right? And to be clear, that's not a black-white statement. It's just an acknowledgement of the fact that we have a lot more work to do to ensure that all caring and concerned adults are operating in ways that put our students at the center, and then it supports the natural potential that exists within them to show up in the way that Marley and our panelist Maria have, right? And the hardest thing about my job, when I think about some of my colleagues in the room, is that we visit with students who have been told that the brilliance that they naturally possess isn't worth being held, right? There are kids who wake up every single day sometimes experiencing things on the way to and from school that would break the average adult, who question whether or not there will be somebody there to tell them that they love them, that they will support them when they make the mistakes that we all invariably make, or that the thing that they think is uniquely weird about them is something that is actually not that special, right? And the thing that we all have to acknowledge is that sometimes, right, we overcomplicate things. At the core of what we're talking about is ensuring that all of our babies have at minimum a caring and concerned adult who will support them throughout their life with love. We can talk about the pedagogy or the manipulatives or the spaces and places after that. But if we all just honor, and I am rereading because sometimes we need the inspiration. She did not know that I was gonna have this book here, but I'm rereading The Dream Keepers in part because that's what all of you are. The keepers of dreams of babies who don't know that they can't change the world until we tell them they can. And I'm saying this because I know it's not easy. The work you do is exhausting. You have to give of yourself, every part of yourself, to show up and affirm the babies in ways that allow them to move through the world like this. But it is what you were called to do. You were purposed to do this work. And if you don't do it, nobody else will. So I'm taking this moment to have a conversation with the congregation, because I'm hopeful that this moment gives you that which you need to dig in when that baby shows up that you just want to shake. Or you have the conversation with the colleague that makes you ask yourself, why do I continue to do this? Do it for them. Amen. Thank you, and we'll see you again next year.
So much. I want to thank the panel, and Allie didn't do something that I'm going to do for her. She didn't put in a shameless plug for her book called Raising Race Questions. Incredible book, and I can tell you this, don't take it on a plane, because you won't be able to read it because people will be asking you tons of questions. I made that mistake already. So I think the panel is incredible, and we learned a lot. Easy to have these conversations. So thank you so much. I'll see you in the next plenary.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next breakout sessions begin at 11 a.m. Thank you.